Bam! Mr. Taru. Okay, we are going to look at the relationship of between cosine and secant and use that to help teach you how to graph secant and cosecant graphs. Now, if you have already figured out using t-tables, that's how I'm graphing them, to graph sine and cosine, then you already know how to graph secant and cosecant. You just don't know it yet. Now, don't forget on an xy-axis, or when you're graphing trig functions, the x-axis is the domain. It's the theta that you're plugging into your trig function. And the y-axis is your sine, your cosine values, whatever trig function you're using. But I want to show the relationship between cosine and secant by reminding you of your ratios that you use off of the unit circle, that graph of a circle whose radius is 1 and whose origin or center is the origin. Cosine on the unit circle is x over r, and secant is r over x. Now, a couple of really interesting things happen there. Biggest deal is, and why these graphs will look pretty different, is when you set your denominator, when you're using the values of x or y as your denominator, well, as you rotate around the unit circle, and those x's and y's, as you get to the quadrantal angles, those x and y values can bring on a value or take on a value of 0. Well, we can't divide by 0, so any rotation that gives me an x value for secant or a y value for cosecant, any quadrantal angle that gives you that divisor of 0 is going to set up an undefined function, and that's where we have our vertical asymptotes. So any place along the graph or a unit circle that makes the cosine function 0 is going to make the secant function undefined. And if there is no vertical shift, that's going to be the x-intercepts. But a lot of these graphs will have vertical shifts to them. So don't think that the vertical asymptotes are going to happen just where the graph crosses the x-axis. I like to remind my students that we're graphing by using the easy points off of the unit circle, the zeros, the ones, and the negative ones. Well, those kind of get hidden when you have, say, amplitude change, and maybe you're going from 3 to negative 3, and really get hidden and sort of muffled when you start talking about vertical transformations. So I like to say that the vertical asymptotes, and I haven't even drawn one yet, but they don't happen at the min values or the max values, but the middle points, where the sine or cosine was 0 before the vertical shift. Okay, so there is no vertical shift though. This is the parent function y equals cosine of x. So any place where the x value or the cosine value is 0 on the unit circle for secant is going to be undefined. So that is going to set up an asymptote through the point or through the x coordinate, in this case, negative pi over 2. Okay, again, if cosine is 0 on the unit circle and you find the reciprocal for secant, you're going to be doing 1 divided by 0, which is undefined. At pi over 2, the cosine function is 0. At pi over 2, x is 0, cosine of 0 is 0, that's great, or cosine of pi over 2 is 0, but the secant of pi over 2 is 1 over 0, which is undefined, and that's going to set up another vertical asymptote. And indeed, anywhere that I'm going through the middle point, not the max or the min value, but the middle point, I'm going to set up a vertical asymptote, because that's where the secant graph, or the cosecant graph, if I was using sine as my guide, would be undefined. Okay, well, let's take the min values. Like, at let's start like the standard unit circle values. At 0, the cosine of 0 is 1. Well, if you find secant of 0, secant's the reciprocal of cosine, when you take 1 and you flip it, you still get 1. So my secant graph is going to use that point. It's going to have that in common. At pi, if you rotate pi radians, the x value over there is negative 1. So the cosine of pi is negative 1. The secant of pi, therefore, is the reciprocal of negative 1, which is still going to be negative 1. Now, I like to say that secant graphs are just the cosine graphs blown up or turned inside out. The secant graphs or the cosecant graphs or the sine graph just twisted inside out. Why do you get this sort of twisting motion? What the heck am I talking about? Because you haven't even seen me finish one example yet. Well, think of, you know, this is a value of 1. So now we're approaching 0. The cosine value is approaching 0. Well, let's say the cosine value is 1/2. Like the cosine of 60 degrees is 1/2. Well, if you take the value of 1/2 and you flip it, right, because we're graphing secant, which is the reciprocal of cosine, if you take the value of 1/2 and you flip it, you get the value of 2. If you take a value, a y value that's 1/10, and that's not on the unit circle, but just getting this idea of what happens when you take a very small y value, a very small value when you find the reciprocal, like 1/10 flipped is going to be 10. So where the cosine graph is approaching 0, again, because we're only approaching 0 because there's no vertical shift, but as your cosine value is approaching 0, the secant, which is the reciprocal, 1/2 flipped is 2, 1/5 flipped is 5, 1/10 flipped is 10. That means the graph is going to shoot up and not down and make this wave, but kind of make a bunch of cup shapes. My students like to call them parabolas, but they are very much not parabolas. So this value of 1 instead of the cosine, which is now really the cosine graph, is just acting as my guide. It's not really the graph that I'm trying to make. I'm trying to be y equals secant of x. Well, instead of going towards the center line, it's going to shoot up at the top. Instead at the bottom, negative 1, the reciprocal of negative 1 is still negative 1. The reciprocal of negative 1/2 will be negative 2, right? So this graph is going to go down and right along the asymptote lines. And then basically, you know, the maximum points of your sine or cosine graph is going to be where the secant or cosecant shoots up, and the min values are going to be where the graph goes down. So the white center line, well, sorry, part of the line, the center white graph, y equals cosine, is acting as a guide to help us graph y equals secant of x, which is actually what we're doing in this video, secant and cosecant. So that's how you use sine and cosine as a guide to help you graph secant and cosecant. So let's actually do another example. Now don't forget, if you're graphing using t-tables, I'm going to say the same thing for all of those graphs, sine, cosine, secant, cosecant, whatever. Start the phase shift and count by a quarter of the period. So we're going to try and graph y equals negative 2 cosecant of x plus pi over 4 plus 1. Now I got a lot of transformations here. I'm going to use this term lightly or loosely. Some math teacher might be screaming when they hear me say this, but amplitude is half the overall height, and the only graphs that truly have trig functions that truly have any measurable height is sine and cosine. But since we're graphing by using the quartiles around the quadrantile angles around the unit circle, and we get those values of 1, 0s, and negative 1s, I still like to talk about the idea of the fake amplitude. So the kids can see, like, you know, if the fake amplitude is 2, then they know that their numbers along the t-table should be 2 units apart. And if they aren't, they know that maybe they've messed up a little bit. So sec, cosecant, you know, this graph that shoots up and down forever doesn't really have a height. So I'm going to kind of put the amplitude in quotations. It's not really amplitude, but I still want to highlight that it's 2. Or that it's a pretend value of 2. So when we make the t-table, we see if as long as our numbers are 2 units apart, we know we've done everything right. The period is 2 pi divided by b. B comes from in front of the x, so it's going to be 2 pi, because it's 2 pi divided by 1. The phase shift, well, the phase shift is c over b, and don't forget your general form is a trig function parentheses bx minus c. Plus 1, well, plus d. I have an addition here, so that means that my c value must have been negative to change that sign. So my phase shift is negative pi over 4 divided by b, which is 1, and you flip that denominator up, that's kind of academic because we're just dividing by 1, but don't forget if you have a fraction over a fraction, you have to flip that bottom number up to figure out the proper phase shift. And anyway, ours is negative pi over 4, which means the graph is going to be shifted to the left that many units. The vertical shift is any kind of constant addition at the end of the equation outside the trig function, so that's 1. And we're going to count by 1/4 of the period, which is 2 pi, so we're going to count by pi over 2. Now my tip from my other video was that, again, with t-tables, and not just sort of allowing the calculator to do all the work for us, is to make sure that your count value, your phase shift, and C are all written with common denominators, so it speeds up the T table a little bit. So I'm going to write this as, I'm going to multiply top and bottom by 2 because I want my count value and my phase shift and my value of C and my T table to all have common denominators. So I'm going to keep doing that in my head for every single number I use in my T table. So that's going to be T tables if you're doing it this way. And if you're not, you probably don't want to watch this video unless you're just interested in really knowing how to graph a trig function and knowing the unit circle and knowing how to work with fractions. Start at the phase shift, negative pi over 4. Now count by 1/4 of the period, all right? So negative 1 plus 2 is 1 pi over 4. And then another 2 pi is 3 pi over 4. And another 2 pi over 4, I forgot the denominator in the last statement, but another 2 pi over 4 is going to be 5 pi over 4. And I need one more point. You need a minimum of 5 for your first period, 7 pi over 4. Okay, just counting by 1/4 of the period. Start at the phase shift, count by 1/4 of the period. Now, we're going to plug all this in. Negative 2. Oh, and here's what we're going to do. We're graphing cosecant, but I'm going to use sine as my guide, okay? So negative 2 sine of negative pi over 4 plus pi over 4 plus 1. So you're kind of getting a review out of graph sine and cosine as well. This is 0. The sine of 0 is equal to 0. And I'm going to work my way backwards kind of until I get to my multiplication of negative 2. And then I'm going to come back and add the 1 at the end. I am following the order of operations, but it always seems like you're working your way backwards, and then you do your vertical shift at the end. So 0, sine of 0 is 0, 0 times negative 2 is 0, plus 1 is 1. And negative 2 times sine of pi over 4 plus pi over 4 plus 1. Well, 1/4 and 1/4 is 2/4. So that's pi over 2 pi over 4 is pi over 2. And the sine of pi over 2 is 1. 1 times negative 2 is negative 2, plus 1 is negative 1. Next one, negative 2, sine of 3 pi over 4 plus 4 pi over 4 plus 1 is going to be negative 2 sine of 4 pi over 4 plus 1.
Hello.
Bam! Sorry for the interruption, but as it turns out, we were running out of time anyway. So, let's take a look. I finished up my t-table, just showing you where I've plugged all my x-values in, found the y-values, and I've got my x-axis set up here with the y-values, or the x-values, from our table. Now, you'll notice that I go from negative pi over 4 to positive pi over 4, but yet my spacing is all nice and even because these are intervals of 2 pi over 4. So now I'm going to come through, drop my y-axis down where x equals 0. We get that narrower spacing, but then that is a smaller interval. It's 1/4 instead of 2/4. And let's plot our numbers. Negative pi over 4, 1. Pi over 4, negative 1. 3 pi over 4, positive 1. 5 pi over 4 is going to be at 3. And 7 pi over 4 is 1. If I wanted to keep this pattern up, I could just keep doing my marks here and get this as my guide. And when you're graphing secant or cosecant, the middle points are going to help you set up your vertical asymptotes. Don't put them through the max or min values. Put them through the middle points. And then the cosecant, now I've actually graphed with all this time, you know, a sine function. But now that sine function is going to act as a guide. And where I have my minimum values, I draw some sort of bowls going down. My max values, I go up, and then down, and then up. And there's, honestly, a quite complicated cosecant function. I reviewed how to graph sine, and boom, that graph acts as a guide, and you're done. So if you can graph sine, you can graph cosecant. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.